Hello everyone, welcome back to the video lecture series on engineering hydrology with me Nihal Levy. Hope all of you are doing fine. In the previous video we covered hydrological cycle and parameters part 3. In that we covered the precipitation measurement and how to find the mean annual rainfall using the different methods like arithmetic mean method, isohyetal method or the Thiessen-Polygon method. Today we are going to start a new component of hydrological cycle, that is evaporation. And before that, we will also be covering what is drought and different types of drought. So let's begin hydrological cycle and parameters part 4. So what is drought? Drought is actually a climatic condition which is characterized by very less rainfall or very less moisture. Okay, and this may result from subnormal rainfall over larger regions causing below normal natural availability of water over a longer period of time. So when over a longer period of time there is insufficient supply of moisture over a larger area, then it may result to drought. Now there are different types of drought. They may be either meteorological drought, hydrological drought or agricultural drought. So let's see one by one. What is meteorological drought? Meteorological drought is a condition where there is more than 25% decrease in precipitation than the normal average precipitation. Okay, so if there is a decrease of 25% precipitation from the normal, then it is meteorological drought. Now the meteorological drought may further be classified into either normal drought or moderate drought or severe drought. So in case of normal drought, we have seasonal deficiency, that is deficiency of rainfall is below 25%. Okay, that is normal. When it is less than 25%, it is simply called normal or drought, you may say. Okay, and if it is moderate, when seasonal deficiency is from 26 to 50%, and when the deficiency is greater than 50%, then you may regard the drought as severe drought. Okay. If the now according to the area, we can divide it either into a drought prone zone or a chronologically drought prone zone and so on. If probability of occurrence is between 0.2 to 0.4, okay, then it may be termed as drought prone area. Okay, so probability is from 0.2 to 0.4, and if probability is greater than 0.4, then it may be termed as chronologically drought prone area. Okay, so it is severely drought prone area. Now another thing is for data. In India, you have 33% area in the drought prone region. Okay, so that is a very huge area. So let's see the second type of drought, that is hydrological drought. Now what is hydrological drought? It is due to when the water content in the different water bodies like lakes, rivers, ponds, etc. go below the average value, then we termed as hydrological drought. And it may be due to either low precipitation, low rainfall, poor management of these water bodies or very increased demand of water due to steep rise in population. Okay, so this overpopulation also has a great role to play in drought conditions. You can see in many metropolitan cities, in Hyderabad and New Delhi, they have, the Niti Aayog has released that till the year 2022, there will be loss of whole groundwater from the underground. Okay, so it may be a severe condition, but I hope that something favorable will come in our case. Okay, the third type is the agricultural drought. Okay, it is a situation when there is deficiency of moisture and which finally results to less production or less harvesting of the crops and plants. Okay, it may be expressed by different indices like the aridity index or the Palmer index. Though this aridity index is more common and it is generally asked in the objective questions, it is given by PET minus AET by PET. Now what is PET? PET is actually potential evapotranspiration and AET is actual evapotranspiration. Potential evapotranspiration is actually the transpiration that is occurring from plants or trees when sufficient moisture is available to them. Okay. So, you may see here refers to amount of water consumed by plants if sufficient moisture conditions is present. Okay, and what happens actually, that is actual evaporation that is taking place, that is represented by AET. Okay, So AET is less than PET. So AET, it refers to actual amount of water consumed by plants under existing conditions or normal conditions. Okay. Now according to this aridity index value, that is PET minus AET by PET, okay, into 100. This is aridity index, and according to aridity index value, we can divide the zones into different. Okay. So if aridity index is less than 0, it is a non-arid zone. Less than 0, what does it mean? That means AET is greater than PET. Actually, evapotranspiration is greater than potential evapotranspiration. Okay. So that is a non-arid zone. Okay. That means sufficient rainfall will be present. If aridity index is between 0 to 25, then it is a mild arid zone. From 25 to 50, it is moderate arid zone, and above 50%, we have the severe arid zone. So just for simple data, this you can remember. Okay. And accordingly, you can, if in the question it is asked which zone, then you can give that. Now the next term that comes in our case is the probable maximum precipitation. What is probable maximum precipitation, or PMP? It is the maximum possible precipitation that can be expected at a given location. Okay. If at a particular location, the maximum amount of precipitation that occurs due to severe rainfall, that is PMP. And it is generally, this data is very important for designing of hydraulic structures like dams or canals. Okay. So I hope this probable maximum precipitation is clear. Now coming to our next component, that is evaporation. Okay. Evaporation. We all know what is evaporation. It is actually a process in which there is a liquid changes from the liquid changes to gaseous form due to, and it is a surface phenomenon. Okay. Different from the boiling. Boiling is actually it occurs throughout the whole mass of the liquid, whereas evaporation is a surface phenomenon, and it occurs below the boiling point, that is 100 degree Celsius. Below 100 degree Celsius, this evaporation occurs. So evaporation goes on occurring at any temperature, okay, be it 2 degree, 3 degree, any temperature evaporation, it goes on occurring continuously with the transfer of heat energy, when heat energy is absorbed by the water body. And latent heat of evaporation is 585 calories per gram. That means for converting 1 gram of liquid to vapor state, we require 585 calories of energy. Okay, so that is latent heat of evaporation. That is the heat required to change the state from liquid to the gaseous state. All this you have studied in your high school. Okay, I hope this is clear. Factors affecting evaporation. Now there are numerous factors that affect the rate of evaporation. Okay. So let's see one by one. First is the vapor pressure. What is this vapor pressure? This is the pressure exerted by atmospheric air. The rate of evaporation is proportional to the difference between saturation vapor pressure and the actual vapor pressure. Okay. So EL, that is rate of evaporation, given in millimeter per day, it is K into ES minus EA. Okay. K here is the coefficient, and ES is the saturation vapor pressure, that is the vapor pressure when air gets saturated, and actual vapor pressure is the vapor pressure that occurs in normal conditions. So this is also the Dalton's law. Okay. So we see that the rate of evaporation increases as this difference goes on increasing. Next factor is the temperature of air and water. Now as the temperature increases, that means heat energy will be more, so evaporation naturally it will be more. So I hope this is clear. Third is the wind speed. Now how wind affects. Now rate increases with increase in wind speed up to critical speed. Now what happens, you just see this graph. Wind speed, and this is evaporation. Okay. So first it goes on increasing, then at some critical value, this becomes constant. Okay. After this, even if you go on increasing the wind speed, there will be no change in rate of evaporation. Now why this happens? Actually, when the, due to evaporation, the air gets saturated with water vapor, then due to this wind velocity, this air gets moved away, and then it is replaced by new mass of air. So this increases the rate of evaporation. So this is how wind speed affects the rate of evaporation. Next is the atmospheric pressure. Now this rate of evaporation decreases with increase in atmospheric pressure. just see this, if this is the water body, okay, and atmospheric pressure, you know, it is acting from upwards into water body. So this will be acting downwards, okay, atmospheric pressure. So it won't allow this water to escape from this water body. Okay, so if we go increasing this atmospheric pressure, then there will be less rate of evaporation. The next is the presence of soluble salts. Now we find that in case of oceans or sea water, the evaporation rate is less. That is due to presence of some insoluble impurities like the soluble salts. Okay, so evaporation rate decreases with presence of soluble salts. Next is the size of water body. Now if you go on increasing the area, that is if we take case of instead of lake we take sea water or ocean, then the rate of evaporation will be larger because it is covered over a larger area. And the next factor is the depth factor. Now how this depth affects, let's see that. In case of shallow body, let's see, okay, this is a shallow body and this is a deep body. In case of well, let's say, okay, so what happens in case of summer season, when the energy falls on the shallow or deep water body, this shallow, as you can see, the area is open, so there is more rate of evaporation because the temperature rises soon. But in case of deep water bodies, in case of summer season, the evaporation rate is less. But what happens in case of winter season? In case of winter, this surface, the shallow water, it gets cooled very soon because the outside atmosphere is at a very low temperature. But in case of deep water bodies, the above gets cooled, but in below we have the water is above. You may say generally, you might have heard that the aquatic organisms, even in winter conditions, they are able to survive the severe conditions. How it is possible? Because above the water freezes, that is 0 degree Celsius, and below it is at 4 degree Celsius. That means it goes on increasing as we go downwards. So just you can see that here the temperature is more, so evaporation will be more in case of deep water bodies in winter season, just the reverse in case of summer season. Okay, so I hope there is no confusion regarding the effect of depth on evaporation rate. Now moving on to the next, that is how to measure this evaporation value. Okay, now there are different methods. First method is by evaporimeter. It is an instrument. And then we will be studying about some empirical methods given by different scientists. So coming to evaporimeter, it is water containing pans exposed to atmosphere and loss of water by evaporation. Okay, so it is actually a pan. Okay, I am drawing the front view. It is actually a circular pan. Okay, it is exposed to the atmosphere and from there evaporation takes place. Okay, it has a particular depth of around 255 millimeter, and it is placed on a wooden deck. Okay, it is of about 15 centimeter or 150 millimeter. Okay, and about 18 to 20 centimeter depth of water is placed on this, and then we go on calculating the depth after particular duration of time. And from that we can conclude the, we just multiply it with pan coefficient, that is Cp, into this depth, that is depth of evaporation that is occurring in this pan, and then we can calculate the actual evaporation that is occurring from water bodies. So this depends on the Cp value, that is pan coefficient value. It may be different for different type of pans. Okay, so this there are two types of pan, basically class A evaporation pan used by US. Okay, it consists of standard pan of 1 to 10 millimeter diameter. This diameter is 1 to 10 millimeter and depth, as I told, 255 millimeter, and used by US Weather Bureau. And depth of water maintained at 18 to 20 centimeter, and pan made of unpainted galvanized iron sheet. So this pan is made of unpainted galvanized iron sheet to prevent it from rusting. Okay, now the second type is the IS pan or Indian standard pan used by Indian Meteorological Department. It is also called a modified class A pan. Okay, and it, how is it different from the class A pan? It is actually consists of a hexagonal wire netting also. Okay, why this netting is provided? Just to prevent the water from birds, okay, and also to maintain uniform temperature during day and night, okay. Due to this presence of wire netting, the temperature is maintained uniform both during the day and night conditions. So these two are the reasons. First is to protect the water from the birds, and second is to maintain uniform temperature. So these are two are the different phenomena that are occurring in IS pan. And evaporation here, as this is green, so this will be less than the class A evaporation, that is 14% less than the unscreened pan. Now, as I told, the pan coefficient, lake coefficient, evaporation, it is not the same actually as the pan evaporation. Why? Because there may be different factors in pan evaporation. The evaporation might be occurring more due to some or other reason. So we have to multiply that by some coefficient, that is Cp, and this value is always less than the 1. Okay, that means this lake evaporation will always be less than pan evaporation, because there might be some impurities also, as you studied in the factors, that the presence of soluble salts, it decreases the evaporation rate, so that might also be a cause. So for class A pan, we have Cp value 0.6 to 0.8, and average value for now let's see the pan evaporation, that is pan coefficient value. Okay, now this lake evaporation is not the same as pan evaporation. Why? Because there may be different reasons, because of like you have studied in the factors that due to presence of soluble salts, the evaporation rate decreases, and there might be other reasons as well, because of storage capacity, heat storage capacity of lake might be different from the pan. Okay, so we have to multiply it by some coefficient, that is Cp. As I told, this is the pan coefficient, and this value is always less than 1. That means lake evaporation will always be less than pan evaporation. So there are different Cp values for class A and IS pan method, and the average value for class A is 0.7 and for IS pan it is 0.8. Why IS pan it is greater? As I told, that IS pan has some screening, okay. So evaporation will be less, that is 14% less. So we have to increase this Cp value, okay. So this will be helpful to you in the numericals. Now some empirical formulas. First formula is given by Mayers, and it is based on Dalton's law. That is, I have already told you, El is equal to K into Es minus Ea. Es is the saturation vapor pressure and Ea is the actual vapor pressure. So it is El is equal to K into Es minus Ea in brackets 1 plus U9 by 16. Now what is this U9? U9 is actually the velocity of wind in kilometer per hour at 9 meter above ground level. Okay, so 9 here signifies the actual altitude at which we are measuring the velocity, that is 9 meter above the ground level, and this value has to be in kilometer per hour. So as it is an empirical formula, so you just have to remember the units, okay. You just can't use the SI units. And K is the coefficient depending on the depth. This coefficient K depends on the depth, that is for shallow water body. As shallow water body, there is more evaporation in summer season, so it is about 0.5 in case of shallow, and in case of deep it is around 0.35, okay. So this K value depends on the depth of water body. And EL, you know, it is evaporation in millimeter per day, that is rate of evaporation. And this U9, that is average velocity value, we can find using this 1 by 7th power law, okay. V1 by V2 is equal to H1 by H2 whole to the power 1 by 7. So if velocity at a particular height is given, then you can find the velocity at 9 meter using this formula, okay. For example, if H1 is given as 2 meter, V1 is given as 5 meter, so you can calculate the value of V2 that will be used here, okay. And H2, you know, you use it for 9 meter. So just you can calculate using this 1 by 7th power law the value of velocity V2, okay. I hope this Mayer's formula is clear to you. Now coming to some analytical methods, okay. First, we will studying about water budget method, then on energy budget method. So, water budget method, it is based, as the name suggests, it is based on the conservation of water or the conservation of mass principle, okay? And it is the simplest method, but it is the least reliable method. Now, let's see what happens in this. Here, we are actually equating the net incoming mass of water to the net outgoing mass. So, whatever is coming, that is in the form of precipitation or inflow, that we are equating with the net outgoing mass, that is the evaporation or the storage which is taking place or the transpiration loss, okay. So, this P stands for precipitation, VIS is actually surface inflow, okay. VIG is actually groundwater inflow, E is the evaporation, okay. VOS is actually the surface outflow, and VOG is groundwater outflow, TL is the transpiration loss, and delta S is change in storage. So, this delta S, it can be either positive or negative. That means if the storage is increasing, then delta S is positive. Okay, so it is delta S2 minus S1. This is S final minus S initial. Okay, and just you can see this diagram once again. First, the precipitation is occurring. Okay, and some this is the water body initial level. So this is VIS, that is coming incoming inflow on the surface, and some of it is percolating downwards. And this is the ground level. Okay, and it is forming the VIG, that is groundwater inflow, and then this is the VOG, that is groundwater outflow, and we have VOS, that is surface outflow, and due to this precipitation there will also be increase in some storage. This is delta S here, this is increasing, that is delta S is positive here. So just you can equate this using this conservation of mass principle. Now the next method is the energy budget method. Now here, as the name suggests, it is based on the law of conservation of energy, okay. So let's see this diagram, it will make it clear. Solar incoming solar radiation is, let's say it is HC, okay, denoted by HC, and some of it gets reflected, that is gamma into HC, this gets reflected, and some of it gets refracted, that is 1 minus R into HC, okay, 1 minus R into HC. And some of it also goes as back radiation, that is HB. So net radiation that is coming into this water body, what it is value HN, that is denoted by HN, it is given as HC 1 minus R, that is getting refracted, minus HB, that is back radiation that is occurring. So this is the net radiation that is incoming. Now let's see what are the losses that are occurring. First is this is HA. HA is evaporation heat loss due to air, okay, HA, which is due to the heat energy. Then HE is the loss due to evaporation, this we have to evaluate, okay. HG is the heat flux into the ground, okay, the heat which is lost into the ground. HS is actually the heat stored in the water body. Now this heat doesn't goes anywhere, it gets stored in this water body. And HI is the heat loss due to advection, okay. Advection is basically due to flow of water, the heat loss which occurs, that is advection. So this is HI. So just we have to equate this HN with all these terms, and we will get it as HE is denoted as rho LE, okay, that is heat loss due to evaporation. Rho actually is the density, okay, L is the latent heat of vaporization, okay, and E is the evaporation loss, okay. This may be in millimeter. So this heat loss due to evaporation, it can be evaluated from this, okay. So and one more important factor comes here into role, that is the Bowen's ratio. It actually gives a relation between HA and HE. HA is the heat loss due to air, heat lost to air, and HE, as I told, heat loss due to evaporation. So HA becomes HE into eta. Okay. So, we can just use this equation here. HN is equal to HA, you can write as rho LE into beta plus HE, you can write as rho LE plus HG plus HS plus HI. Okay. So, HN by HN, you can write further as HC 1 minus R minus HB, HN by this, you may also neglect some of these values, like sometimes this HG or HI, it may be neglected in question, and then you can, or here you can write as HN minus HG plus HS plus HI by, you have to find what? You have to find this evaporation loss in millimeter. So, rho L, this will be common, and this will be 1 plus beta. Okay, this will be the value of E, that is evaporation loss in millimeter. Okay, so I hope this formula is clear to you. So, this was the energy budget method for calculating the evaporation depth. Okay. Now, some another method is also there, that is mass transfer method based on the theory of turbulency. Okay. What does this method suggest? This method is based on the theories of turbulent mass transfer in boundary layer to calculate the mass of water vapor transfer from surface to the surrounding atmosphere. Okay. So, it is given as VE is equal to AEP into CP. So, this EP and CP are actually coefficient, that is EP is pan evaporation that is occurring and CP is relevant pan coefficient that we have studied in the previous slides, and A is the average reservoir surface area in kilometer square or meter square, whatever you may say, and V is the volume of water that is lost in evaporation, this will be in meter cube. Okay, so this was the mass transfer method, just remember this formula. It is actually volume is equal to area into depth multiplied by some coefficient. Okay. So, I hope this is clear. So, we come to the end of this video. Hope you enjoyed it. In the next video, we will be taking on some numericals regarding what we studied today. And we will starting with different components of hydrological cycle, that is evapotranspiration. And how to measure evapotranspiration using lysimeter and some other empirical methods. So, see you in the next video. You can also practice free quizzes at GradeUp and always be a grade higher. Thank you and all the best.